أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله الذي أنزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا. الصلاة والسلام على خير خلق ونور عرش أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبنا وسيدنا وسندنا وشفيعنا ومولانا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتاب المجيد وقوله الحق وهو أصدق الصادقين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصلوا بالحق وتواصلوا بالصبر. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات الله على محمد وعلى محمد. I begin in Allah's name, the Beneficent, the Merciful, and all praise belongs to Allah. Because He created us, He has given us everything that is beautiful and given us the potential to exist forever. And He has granted us this life, a life which requires us to struggle, a life which is filled with beauty, but it is also filled with distractions. It is a life in which ourself has to evolve from the state of nafsi ammara to nafsi mutma'inna. And the brief definition of that is nafsi ammara is the self that is very selfish, very centered, self-centered. And it is the type which is very material. And children who are born have this natural propensity to selfishness. We find young children, they're very self-centered. They want everything for themselves. And their friends also are only important because of themselves. And it's about ourselves as children. And even when we are infants, we don't care if our parents are tired. We don't care if they haven't slept. We don't care if they're hungry. We cry because we demand food. And that demand is material, it's natural. They say if the baby doesn't cry, then the mother will not know when to feed it. Because it's just the natural call. Transaction. This level of nafs is a good nafs to have. It's a material self, it's a selfish self. It's good to be there, but for a period of time. And Allah demands from us over time that we should progress and we should get out of this state of material selfishness and we should start evaluating the why and what the vision and the purpose of life is. But when we focus on why we exist and what is our mission in life, and if we do take what is our mission in life as an essential part of our existence, then we will begin to act in that direction. It's just like when you start a company, you ask the person, what do you want? He says, I want to maximize my profits. That's my vision. I want to produce a top quality product. I want to be a world-renowned company. You know, I want to compete in the world of business and I want A, B, or C. Whatever the vision is. Like Microsoft's vision with Bill Gates was a PC on every desk. This was their vision. Microsoft had it ingrained, a PC on every desk. This was their vision, because for every PC, every personal computer on a person's desk, was a software called Microsoft. And that was how they became so powerful and big, right? The vision of Google, on the other hand, is to take complicated information and simplify it. Manage information. That's Google's strength. When Google became powerful, it was because it took a very simple concept and it put it in practical terms and was able to give me results in a complicated web of excessive information within a millisecond to tell me what I was looking for, to sift through this array of data and to give me the simplest information that would guide me. And that's the strength of Google today, until today. While companies were having search engines plastered with all kinds of advertisements, the Google page was just one text box. Simple, succinct, but brilliant. That's the vision. So the question you and I have to ask is, what's my vision as a human being? What's my vision as a believer? What's my vision tomorrow? How do I see myself as an old man or a woman? How do I see my generations? Do I have a vision of what I think my generations will be doing for what I have done in this world? Can I be a legacy? Can I set something in motion so that my next generation uses what I've prepared to higher ground? If we don't think this way, then we won't produce it. It doesn't come haphazard. You have to have a vision. See, Joel Osteen inherited the evangelical church in Houston, Texas, from his father. He's a very world-renowned speaker, as you know, Joel Osteen. He packs a stadium when he speaks. But his father was the traditional evangelist. He said, no. When he inherited it, when his father died, he inherited the whole church. It was under his control. But he wasn't a true practicing Christian. If you look at Joel Osteen, he's not one of those zealous fundamentalist Christians. He's not. But he inherited a church. So he figured out that the way I will maintain the continuity of this church is use this platform and be a motivational speaker through Christ. And today he fills a stadium where there are Christians and non-Christians who attend his presentations, because if you listen to the essence of what he speaks about, it's motivational. He motivates societies. But what did he do? He had a vision. Either he gives up his father's inheritance, or he capitalizes on it and takes it to the next level. And today, he has a $100 million, you know, evangelical movement, you know, very, very powerful movement, but he had a vision. So you and I need to have a vision in life. What are we going to accomplish? Allah has blessed us with prophets, has blessed us with imams. We cry for our imams and prophets, especially our imams like Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam when he was shaheed in Karbala. But the question you and I have to ask is, what am I going to do with his shahada? So he died, he was butchered, he was massacred, his family was butchered. And I feel the pain of injustice that was meted up upon them when they shouldn't have been dealt with such injustice. So what can I do 14 centuries later to be somebody who raises a flag to say, I vociferously condemn the actions of Yazid, and I am a supporter of Ahlul Bayt and Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam in Karbala. What do I do? You will notice that even people like, just general examples of people like Mothers Against Drunk Driving. It's an organization in the United States where mothers have formed an organization where their sons and their husbands and their daughters have been killed, where they created these organizations called Mothers Against Drunk Driving because they were so disturbed by people who drink and drive that they decided to create legislation against drunk driving. But they needed a movement. And where did the movement come from? You will see movements come when you are affected by it. So Mothers Against Drunk Driving are the founders of mothers whose loved ones were killed due to drunk driving. So you notice that people who rise to the occasion, you see, are the ones who suffer through that pain. And they feel that my son was killed unnecessarily on the highway, and I lost my beloved due to some foolish act, but I can't go to sleep at night, you know, biting the bullet and just being patient and dying and growing old, knowing that there was an injustice that took place. What do they do? They say the only way we can understand the reality of this injustice is to rise and fight for justice, because that gives us reason that when our son was killed on the highway, that now our son's spirit continues to grow through his name, that we are going to now establish justice in the world. Isn't that true? Notice, Adam Walsh, you know, he was butchered as a young child. He was beheaded and thrown in the river. His father, who founded America's Most Wanted, said, I could not sleep at night knowing that my young son's life was taken, and I needed to make it an article of faith in my life to go and catch criminals for the rest of my life so that my son's death is validated. See, that's a very proactive move. It's a very honorable move. But what Allah is saying to us is, does it have to take a tragedy in your life for you to rise? Or can you rise before tragedy takes place? The most honorable one is the one who rises before the tragedy takes place. Indeed, the one who rises after a tragedy takes place is even a highly honorable person. Don't underestimate it. What are you and I going to do that this tragedy hasn't really hit us to the degree that some of us may have experienced? So when we love Ahlul Bayt, we say tragedy has struck in my deen. Tragedy has struck among our Shi'i. In Yemen, in Kuwait, look at how many people are being killed in Yemen as we speak. Bombed daily, carpet bombed. Because the tyrant Muawiyah of today is expecting this nation to bow to its knees and bow to this tyrant king. The same way Muawiyah demanded in his time. The same way Yazid demanded in his time. What's the difference then and now? Same, our brethren are being killed, right? They're being displaced. Syria, millions of Syrians, peace-loving citizens of Syria are displaced in camps. And their parents are displaced, their children are displaced, and they don't know what to do. They are broken, shattered. Even if they go back to Syria, it'll never be the same, forever. Yet a decade ago, I was in Syria, more than a decade ago. It was a metropolis. When I went for ziyarah of Sayyidina Zainab alayhi salam, you find that it was a metropolis of people. People are peace-loving. You go, you see churches, you see synagogues, you see mosques. People are coexisting. And shaitan decided to cause chaos, right? You and I have to ask, that bala that is Syria right now, that bala which is Yemen right now, that bala which is Lebanon right now, that bala which is Iraq right now, or Pakistan, or Afghanistan, all of these places, you think it won't hit us? And even if it doesn't hit us, should we not care for that bala? The question you and I have to ask is, what am I going to do? These visions is what gives us vision to direct ourselves, and hopefully our nafs becomes nafs al-lawwama. Allah said, la uqsimu bin nafs al-lawwama. I swear by the self-accusing soul. Self-accusing soul. La uqsimu bin nafs al-lawwama. I swear by this self-accusing soul. You and I should reach that stage from nafs al-ammara. I've seen adults, old people, still coveting. They covet wealth and power and material dignity. They're old, ready to die, but they can't let go. They love power. They love the material, the one who's got the pound in his hand, you know, or the dollar in his hand. $1. He dies, but can't let go. Rigor mortis sets, they break his fingers, take it out. But the person just couldn't let go. Al-Hakum al-Takathur. Takathur is abundance has diverted you. Why? You look at a person like that, no vision. Their vision is so short-term, they are the biggest fools on earth. The biggest fools on earth are those people. They thought, the Firauns of the time, they thought their wealth will give them tranquility. That even the pharaohs, when they died, they used to take all their gold and jewels and hide it inside the pyramids. And they put traps in there so you can't get to the grave. Only thousands of years later, the thieves broke into it and took it all out. And today they're being paraded in museums, and people pay $50, $100 to go see a rotting body of the pharaoh. Allah says, you see this? We'll see it in Al-Ard. See it in Al-Ard. Travel, go see what happened to your predecessors. They thought like you. While you were busy building your empires, they were busy building their empires. And their empires were bigger than yours. They were so big, they built pyramids, the average human being can't build it today. That's how great they were. Where are they now? Dust. Allah says, you don't take lessons. When will you take lessons? Allah says, be self-accusing. look in the mirror and say, I am the problem, therefore I am the solution. Don't just say I'm the problem. Wrong. Always say the following. I am the problem, therefore I am the solution. There's never such a thing that I am the solution, therefore I'm not the problem. No. I am the problem, therefore I am the solution. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. That vision, that gradation of the self, where we leave the material world. Now, when we're 90 years of age, do we have nafs-e ammara? Of course, you can't eradicate it. It's not a bad nafs to have. Nafs-e ammara, which is what you call a material self, the self that's very selfish, inna nafsa la'ammaratun bisu. This nafs is not a bad thing to have, it's a good thing to have, even with old age. But what we have done in old age is we have controlled it like a wild beast. We have tamed it like a wild animal that was tamed. And when we're young, it's a wild animal. As we grow older, there's an expectation for us to tame this wild animal. When you and I tame this wild animal, and we do it through nafs al-lawwama, which is to accuse ourselves, we bring about harmony in society. So the ayah that I start a few nights now, Surah Al-Asr, the time, Allah starts with the negation. Allah swears by time. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. Indeed, mankind is at a loss. Illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr. Notice this ayah starts with a negation. God says, indeed, mankind is at a loss. Innal insana, indeed, mankind is at a loss. Except if you do the following. The exceptions are, believe in Allah, do good deeds, enjoin justice and truth, and enjoin patience. If you and I do that, then Allah is saying you are not at a loss. Now the word is tawasaw. The root word of tawasaw is wasiyah. Wasiyah. When you give wasiyah, when you give wasiyah, meaning you're giving a will, when you're enjoining. See, tawasaw, we need to enjoin on each other justice. Tawasaw bil haqq. Here, haqq is a universal term. Adalat is a subset of haqq. Adal is a subset of haqq. Allah says, خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ بِالْحَقِّ. He created the universe in truth. Haqq means truth. And when we enjoin each other towards the truth, we enjoin each other towards justice. A person comes to our Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I mentioned this many times. He says, I'd like to be a Muslim, but I don't want to pray, I don't want to fast, I don't want to do any of those above. Can I be a Muslim? And the messenger was leaving to go defend Islam at that time. He said, yes, you can. He said, how? How can I be a Muslim without following the injunctions? He says, don't lie. Speak the truth. Live the life of truth. And submit to the truth. And the man said, okay. The messenger comes back and he wants to do his shahada and he becomes a Muslim. The messenger asked him, what brought you? He said, when I looked at the truth, it brought me to you. When I looked at the truth, it brought me to prayers. When I looked at the truth, it brought me to the Islamic injunctions, because the subservience and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the truth. And there's a rational process in that. Trust me, modern day atheists think they are rational, but there's so much misinformation and disinformation that it leaves their rationality out of whack because their assumptions are flawed. And the rule of logic and rationality is you better clarify your assumptions before you go into logical arguments. You better clarify your assumptions. And many times I hear atheists give false assumptions, which leads to false conclusions, which somehow falsely gives them this notion that they're right, when they're not right. See? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us, He says, I created the universe in truth. So when non-Muslims ask me, what's my status on Judgment Day? I say, if you progressively seek the truth, and you progressively submit to the truth, in other words, you don't seek it to use it and abuse it, but you seek it to submit to it, you will be in the grace of God. Really? Yes. Because the Quran says it. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَ وَالصَّالِئِينَ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ. Provided you believe in God in the Day of Judgment, you Jews, Christians, Muslims, believers, Sabians, all of you, there's a condition. آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحِ. And you do good deeds. Allah says, لَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. No fear and don't worry. You're in the grace of God. So what's the principle? The principle is seek the truth, submit to it. And when you look around the world, encourage others to find the truth. When you and I meet Christians and Jews and atheists, don't try to convert them to Islam. It's disingenuous. When I want to convert you to Islam, I want to make you a Muslim. The person says, oh, why, you're lonely, you need company? Is that why you want to make you a Muslim? You know, if somebody comes and tries to proselytize religion to me, I become defensive. You need to accept the Christ. You know, he's going to save you from the eternal damnation. I said, do I have to? He says, yes. If you don't, you're going to go to hell. You're going to fry in hell. I said, well, thank you, but my guard just went up. Like, why do I need to? Says who? Well, I'm here. I care for you. You know, I want to talk to you about. I said, thank you. Let me decide. Don't damn me and condemn me before I start. Don't tell me you're doomed. By the way, you're doomed. But I've got the answer. No. Say, let's have a dialogue. Let's talk the truth. And you decide what you think is the right and what is wrong. You know, there's a great honor when we talk to each other at that level. This is when the Quran says, أَدْوَ إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِدَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. Invite people to the way of your Lord with wisdom and kind exhortation. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنِ. Use sound argumentation. But don't be condescending. Don't shove religion down people's throats. And don't damn and condemn them. You know, you're Hindu, you're an idol worshiper, you're first of all najis. And you go to hell. I've seen people say that. I said, who say it? How dare you say that? Don't say that. That's not Islam. Islam doesn't say that. Islam says, we're all a creation of God. God doesn't like idol worshiping. You know, when I was in one time in a high school and there was a Hindu girl and I was presenting Islam, she says, you make a lot of sense, talk to me more. I said, look, those gods that you have in your temple, is that how God looks? She says, no, it's how we think he looks. I said, how do you know how he looks? Have you seen him? She says, no, it's our imagination. I said, would you imagine your child to look like that? Would you give him an elephant's nose? Imagine your child is born with a big elephant nose? How beautiful he is. Or he has a monkey on his head? It's like a monkey. Now, I'm not pushing down, I'm not making fun of Hinduism. I respect them. But I asked this girl, honestly, I said, is that God? She says, God is beautiful. I said, I agree with you. I agree with you. God is more beautiful than any beauty we can put our eyes on. I said, God is universal. Can you see him? She said, no. I said, then don't you think this is somebody's imagination? And it's tacitly insulting to shape a God this way. I know you have good intentions, but is it fair that if somebody did a picture of me, they heard about me, but they don't know how I look, and then I visited their village, and there was this animal looking, and then my name was below it. And I said, who's this? I said, that was you. We imagined you this way. But that's not fair. Even if you put the most handsome creature on in the picture, I'd say, but that's not me. It's handsome, but it's not me. It's not fair. So we can't. She says, you know, you're right. I didn't think that way. She says, to be honest with you, when I do go to the temple, I get scared with all these idols. I said, that's your choice. She says, I've decided I'm going to worship one God. Because Hinduism is about one God. We are monotheists, she says to me. We believe in one God. I said, bravo. I said, you know, Sai Baba tells you too. All your scholars and gurus say, there's only one God. So why don't we just focus on that one God? And let's not give shapes and forms. مَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَهُ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَهُ إِذَا قَضَى أَمْرًا فَإِنَّمَا يَقُولُ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. It is not for God to even take upon himself a son.
ما كان لله أن يتخذه ولدا سبحانه he is great. So when you have this dialogue, even with Hindus, you notice this young Hindu girl now says to me, I'm resonating with your conversation. I see where you're going. She says, but do you think I'm damned and condemned to hell? I said, stop asking those questions because I don't have that jurisdiction. It is not in my hands to open the doors of paradise, nor to close the doors of paradise or to open the doors of hell. It's not in my jurisdiction, nor is it in yours. You and I have to work together to seek the truth and ask the one who has the door to paradise to grant us entry into paradise. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So let's have that vision, brothers and sisters. When we have this vision and Nasr Lawama comes, we feel obligated. I truly believe if we're lovers of Ahlul Bayt and we love Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam and we love what they have stood for after the Messenger and we love for their patience, then you and I have a mission. You and I have a vision. I promise when I go, and I swear, when I go in public, when I'm standing on a pulpit, even in the most, in areas where I find a lot of enemies, I find strength knowing that I am doing my best to represent Ahlul Bayt. A small little speck of me, but I'm holding the banner of Ahlul Bayt. That when I'm in public and even among academicians and erudites, I'm not afraid of them. I'm afraid of my own ignorance. That's all I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of my own stupidity, my own jahiliyyah, my own arrogance. That I'm afraid of. Because nothing can destroy me more than that. But I'm not afraid of people. I'm honored. And when I stand and when I attacked even verbally by people, it's very rare, but when I am, I don't fear them. I look at them and I remember my master, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib, how he fended off all the arrows that came and how he defended and brought truth to the public. Tawassaw bil-haq wa tawassaw bil-sab. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. My brothers, today, tonight, in this journey of understanding tawassaw bil-haq wa tawassaw bil-sabr, we have an exemplary role model. A female, a woman of the highest stature who left this world 14 centuries ago. And it's none other than Khadija bint Khuwaylid alayha salam, the wife of the Holy Prophet, the only beloved wife of the Holy Prophet in his lifetime, the one he loved dearly, the one the Messenger said, Khadija and I will be in paradise together. This woman, in my opinion, exemplifies an ultimate role model for men and women on how we should model our women and how we should look for ourselves within her as role model for us. Khadija bint Khuwaylid, as you know, was the cousin of the Holy Prophet. She was born in Mecca and she was the cousin of the Holy Prophet. But she was a wealthy merchant who she inherited that business from her father when he passed away. So she didn't start the business, she inherited it. And then she took it to higher grounds and she became even wealthier. But she wasn't an enterprising woman where she was brushing shoulders with men. She was in the haya. She was within the walls of dignity. And she is a woman who never worshipped idols. Khadija bint Khuwaylid never worshipped idols. Abu Talib alayhi salam never worshipped idols. Abdul Muttalib alayhi salam never worshipped idols. They mention, in fact, Abu Talib alayhi salam, when he recited the marriage of the Holy Prophet and Khadija, he said, we who have been placed as guardians of the religion of Ibrahim when prophets are not present. Look, he's telling us, he's an imam. In his khutbah, when he's reciting the marriage of the Holy Prophet to Khadija, you know who recited the marriage? Was Abu Talib. So I ask you, if Abu Talib was an idol worshipper, how can such a marriage be recited by him? Abu Talib, alayhi salam, just a quick footnote, was married to Fatima bint Asad, the mother of Imam Ali, alayhi salatu wasalam. She was one of the first Muslimah in Islam, among the women, to accept Islam in the early stages. Abu Talib remained married to her till his death. How could that be possible when the injunction of Allah came that those who are idol worshippers and refused to become Muslims, their marriage is severed? How was she married to him till his death? But there are groups of people in the world today, even historians, who try to distort the name of Abu Talib alayhi salam because he is the father of the second greatest human being that walked this earth, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa they got to smear him. But Abu Talib was present in the wedding, in the marriage of Khadija. And let me give you a brief history about Khadija alayhi salam, that she achieved very high standards but highly dignified. She was the most sought after woman in Arabia for marriage. She was magnificent, they say her beauty was impeccable, and she was sought after because she was dignified. She was pure. Tahira was one of her titles. She was pure. That's how beautiful a woman she was in her purity. And the messenger used to always reflect about her, how beautiful she was. That even in the later stages after her shahada, when the other wives came into the picture, one of them, as we know famously, was jealous of the messenger loving Khadija. And he said to her that no one can supersede Khadija. She was the first person who accepted Islam when God commanded me to announce it in public. She was already a Muslim. She was already a Muslim, huh? But she publicly accepted Islam when the mission started. The messenger said she was the first one to believe in my truthfulness when others did not accept it. She was the first one to believe in my truthfulness. She consoled me, she protected me, she defended me, and she expended all her wealth for the love of God. Who can supersede Khadija, the Prophet used to reply. Who can supersede this woman that her and I will be in paradise together? That's how much Khadija was. Now we think that in Islam, men are the financiers. Typically we are men, because Allah has commanded the men to go out and earn a living. But interestingly and ironically, it was a woman, Khadija, none other than her, who financed all of Islam. Today's Islam that we have, and the growth of Islam, and the perfection of Islam as it has reached the day Imam Ali alayhi salam was given his successorship, that financing came from Khadija alayhi salam. So let us not second think about our women, and second guess our women into thinking that they are second class citizens. No, the Quran does not distinguish the differences when it comes to male and female in the same surah that I'm discussing. Ya ayyuha an-nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha waja'alnakum shu'uban wa qaba'ila lita'arafu inna akramakum 'indallahi atqakum. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we made you male and female, nations and tribes, so you know each other. But the most honorable among you to God is one who is God conscious. So indeed Khadija alayhi salam is most honorable to Allah. Hands down, she's a woman. But today in society, as much as women are fighting for their rights and sometimes excessively, men are also bullies and belligerent. Today we find men who beat their wives in their homes. They come religious, pious in the masjid. They come standing in line, prayerful, but then they are harsh to their wives because they're weaker. They are the weaker of the gender. And generally when it comes to corporal punishment, what we call spousal abuse, we see that it's usually the man who is the abuser. This is haram. And then the person has the audacity, some of us within Islam, we have the temerity, as we say, to quote an ayah of the Quran, فَضْرِبُوهُنَّ, that we have the authority to beat our wives. Who gave you this authority? I beg to differ, and I dare you to come forward and stand on the platform and present this nonsense argument that I've been given the right to beat my wife. Haram. We see this today. I travel the globe. I see mothers come to me, sisters come to me, husbands come to me when their wives are beating them. Who has authorized beating? Which Islam has allowed with impunity that you can come and beat and strike anyone? This is a person who doesn't know Allah. This is a person who is abusing the religion of Allah. It is haram to have this. Our prophets and our imams were gentle. They never even struck an animal. The messenger used to carry a stick. He used to touch his animal, never strike it. Never did he strike it once. Whereas an animal, one could say, has the right to be struck because it's an animal. Even then the messengers didn't do it. Who gave us the impunity? Who gave us this right to come and strike each other? This is not tawassul bil haqq. This is not tawassul bis sabr. This is khasara. The Quran negates followed by an exception. Just quick example. I'll continue with Khadija alayhi salam. You will notice that when the Quran negates followed by an exception, it leaves no room for argument. Whenever there's an ayah with a negation followed by an exception, the Quran is leaving no room for arguments. It's making a very strong message. Whenever God negates, like La ilaha illallah, there is no God but Allah, this becomes very powerful. Because Allah is saying there is no room for argument. You cannot say that there's a God out there. Allah says there is no God but Allah. That's very powerful. You notice when the Quran says, La as'alukum alayhi ajran, I want no reward from you. The messenger, when he was asked, what reward can we give you? He negated everything. قُلْ لَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا I want no reward from you. إِلَّا الْمَوَدَّةَ فِي الْقُرْبَةِ Except that you have mawadda with my near ones. Because that's Islam. When you have mawadda of the near ones, you will maintain Allah. You will maintain the Quran. You will maintain Salah. And you will follow the Holy Prophet. Mawadda. What is mawadda in Arabic? Mutual love. Mutual. Meaning they've already loved us. Now it's upon us to love them. That's mawadda. Even marriage, Allah uses mawadda. وَمِنْ آيَاتٍ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً And of his signs is he made mates from yourselves. And he put mawadda and mercy. إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَاتٍ لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ These are signs for a community that thinks. Mawadda. That means when couple get married, it's mawadda, mutual. It doesn't mean you can strike your wife or you can strike your husband and you can beat your children. No, mutual love. Do unto others as you done what done unto you. What do you think bullies are? Bullies, today our children suffer a lot in schools with bullying. Some kids have even killed themselves because they've been bullied so much. And today we have cyberbullying. Cyberbullying is very popular these days where people taunt you online and they belittle you online. And children have gone mad to the extent that they have shut their doors and not left their homes because of their fear of bullying. Who usually bullies? The individual who lacks confidence in Allah. What I call a wretched troublemaker. And who usually do you think they bully? They bully victims who are easily bullied. You'll generally find women who get battered by their husbands are usually the ones who can receive the battering. And sadly, those women, when they're being battered, they love their husbands so much that while they turn black and blue, they still don't quit loving their husbands because they feel it is their right to love their husbands. And the husband knows that no matter how much I beat this woman, she will keep loving me to the extent that the husbands even threaten them that if you leave me, I'll kill you. Is that mawadda? Is this the love? We claim to love Ahlul Bayt. Tell me which Ahlul Bayt, which prophet practiced this? Which prophet did this haram act? Khadija and the Holy Prophet were beloved companions. She took her wealth and spent it all for Islam, and she financed all of Islam to the extent that when she died, she didn't have even one piece of gold in her hand. She didn't even have money for kafan. Did you know that? You know the shroud that she's buried in? She didn't even have that money for that. Did you know that? That's how much she expended. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, look at these individuals. Fi buyutin adina Allah an turfa'a wa yudhkara fiha ismuhu. Yusabbihu lahu fiha bil ghuduwi wal asal. Rijalun la tulhihim tijaratun wa la bay'an an dhikrillah. Wa iqam as-salati wa ita'i az-zakat. This ayah in Surah An-Nur, Allah exemplifies houses which God has honored and they are remembered. He is remembered through them. فِي بُيُوتٍ أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَن تُرْفَعَ وَيُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ That means when we mention Ahlul Bayt, Allah says this is ibadah. Because when you mention Ahlul Bayt, you mention me. Why? Because I sent the best role models. Why? So you practice that. It's not only a theory in the Quran, it's Quran and Natiq. Our prophets and our imams are Quran and Natiq. The Holy Prophet is the walking, talking Quran. Ahlul Bayt are the walking, talking Quran. We say the Quran is infallible. Therefore we know the Ahlul Bayt and the Prophets are infallible. Because they are the walking, talking Quran. They have to be infallible. But when we give lip service to them and we say how great they are, why don't we practice that? And then in the garb of religion, we come and pray. I was in a time in Africa one time and I heard a group of older men you know, abusing young children in haram ways. And I see them on the front line of the prayers. It's repulsive to see that. Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ. Woe to that prayerful one. When he abuses, وَيُتْعِمُونَ ta'ama. They give ta'am who? The believers. But who's the one on the opposite side? Huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. The Ashab al-Fim, the community of Fim. Is the Quran saying, have you seen what we did to the Ashab al-Fim? Go and see when they were upstanding there with their arrogance, Allah destroyed them. How about the one who claims to be religious? أَرَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ. Have you seen the one who belies the religion? فَذَلِكَ الَّذِي يَدُّعُ الْيَتِيمِ. The one who is an enemy of the orphan. وَلَا يَحُدُّ عَلَىٰ تَعَامِ الْمِسْكِينِ. They hold back the food for the hungry, for the poor. Allah says, look at these groups. This group that's arrogant, thinking they've got elephants they can take. This group that they think that they can come in the front, فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُصَلِّينَ. They can come and be prayerful. Allah says, where is your tawassul bilhaq? Where is your tawassul bilsab? When I send prophets and examples for you as the best role models, you're using religion for a joke? That's why there's apathy in our societies today. That when we see people who claim to be within religion, but when they don't practice, the next generation says, why should I follow? If this very person on the front line leading prayers is molesting children, beating his wife, robbing the people, or in business cheating every single day, but then he comes prayerful and looks very pious, the child says, you know what, I don't want that. That's hypocrisy. This is why many a time when I look at our young generations and they have no desire to pray, it's because they say, we see too much hypocrisy. I said, you see hypocrisy, that means you see good in it. But people are not practicing it. My advice to you is take the good and give up the hypocrisy. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You know, I'm speaking on many fronts here tonight. But I see Khadija alayhi salam as one of the four, she's undoubtedly one of the four chosen women of the world. As you know, Asiya bint Muzrahim, Maryam bint Imran, Khadija bint Khuwaylid, as we're discussing, alayhi salam, and of course Fatima bint Zahra, salamullahi alayha. What fascinates me is these great women are exemplary role models. Look for example, you look at Asiya bint Muzahim, the wife of Fir'aun. You couldn't get a more treacherous man mentioned in the Quran than Asiya. I mean, than Fir'aun. Treacherous man. Yet she's married to this treacherous tyrant. And Allah shows an example. ضرب الله مثلا للذين كفروا امرأة نوح وامرأة لوط كان تحت عبدين من عبادنا صالحين فخانتاهما. We give you an example. Surah Al-Tahrim, Surah number 66. Read it. It talks about womanhood. It talks about the wives of the Prophet. And it shows the exemplary role model that Allah has raised among women. That they carry the banner of Islam. That they're not second-class citizens. They are like the other side of the bird's wing. The bird has two wings. Neither side can be flipped across. Each side is essential for the bird to fly. And each side needs to flap. And if you cut one side, it can't fly. It will go into a tailspin. Both sides need to fly. And both sides need to be given their freedom for the freedom of that bird, which is the individual. The individual society is made up of men and women. Today, we marginalize our women. Even within our Muslim communities, especially in our Eastern countries, we see them as second-class citizens. That if a girl refuses to get married, we throw acid on her face. Not we, those foolish people. They throw acid on their faces because then they don't want anyone to marry them. This is haram. God will punish them. This is dhulam. This is khasara. Oh, we see women as not intelligent. No, women are intelligent. You look at Fatima Zahra salamu alayhi wa, when she spoke, when her fadak was taken, and she went to the court of Abu Bakr, and she spoke, people were stunned by her wisdom. She was the female prophet representative. Remember that. She was, the prophet says, Fatima bid'at min. She is of me. Ummi abiha. She is the mother of her father. And when she would walk in the room, the prophet would stand up. Even when she was in the womb of Khadija, when Khadija alayhi salam would walk, the Prophet would stand up. Not only for Khadija, but for Fatima al-Zahra. That is the akhlaq of Rasulullah. The akhlaq of Rasulullah is to see both genders with barakah, with rahmah, with ni'mah. Our women today, as much as they are blessed with the freedoms of not having necessarily from the injunction of Allah to have to go out and make a living. Today our women are busy doing mundane things when they should be acquiring knowledge. They are the mothers of our children. They are busy gossiping. One thing I must say when I speak in public, you'll find our sisters mature much faster than brothers. Usually in gatherings, it's the girls who sit and carefully listen. Young one. These young boys usually are rambunctious. They have very little time. They generally have, you know, little attention, and then they want to run. They want to kick each other, jump and punch and run and do flips. But the sisters generally will sit and they'll talk and they'll discuss and they'll reflect, because motherhood sets early in them. That's why their maturity is early. But I always advise our sisters that you are the mothers of our children. You are some of the most powerful people, no doubt besides fathers, in our societies. If you do not acquire knowledge, and you do not abstain from gossiping and fault-finding and revelry in garbs and showing off your jewelries and your fashions and indulge in positive, proactive lifestyle, our generations will improve. There's a brother in Dubai, he says to me, every Thursday my business goes up with diamonds and gold. He works at Damas, you know, the jeweler. I said, really, why? He says, your community, all the women come in, they're wealthy, they buy jewels every Thursday. I said, really? He says, yeah, they have to show off. Whatever chain they wear, it's old fashioned, now they have to wear something new. I said, I can't imagine within 52 weeks how much jewel they must have accumulated just to show off on Thursday nights for Dua Kamil. Stop that. It's not where you're important, sisters. Where you're important is intelligence. The messenger said, the most beautiful thing a person possesses is their intelligence. Not what you wear. Wearing is important. Fashion is important. As I mentioned yesterday, looking clean, with clean teeth. The Prophet said, if I could institute 5 times a day to brush your teeth, I would have instituted it. But it's not an institution. But I would encourage you to keep your teeth clean. All of these are good. But that's not where we get our dignity. Our dignity comes with intellect and aql. This is the first thing Allah created. In the universe, Kitab al-Aql wa al-Jahil, in al-Kafi mentioned, the first thing Allah created is aql. Let's be intelligent. Let's be upright. Let's be moral. Let's be good, kind, giving, forgiving, loving, caring and sharing. And you will see the world will love us. So our sisters, especially tonight, I say in the name of the great woman, Khadija bint Khuwaylid alayha salam, that she was a great woman. She was also known as Ummul Mu'mineen. Let me explain Ummul Mu'mineen. Some people have a confused position on this. The wives of the Prophet are considered the mothers of the believers. Now some schools think what that means is they are mothers of believers to the degree that they dictate our affairs. Not true. They think that when you become Ummul Mu'mineen, then hell is haram on you. Meaning you cannot enter hell. And they give reverence to certain wives. And they make them so important that you hear statements from these wives even before they were born. We have hadith of certain wives, even before they were born, they already saw what the Prophet was doing in Mecca. That's how great they are. We've gone astray. We've gone to the extremities. Where Allah says, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ Surah number 33, Surah Al-Ahzab. النبي أولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم وأزواجه أمهاتهم. And the wives are their mothers. So here they take this verse and they say, ah, you see, أم المؤمنين, عائشة أم المؤمنين, حفصة أم المؤمنين, okay. And they think they're so great, they're so revered. But in reality, the reverence is not because of that. There is reverence in being the wife of the Prophet, no question about it. All the wives of the Prophets are revered as wives of the Prophets. Whether they were good or not, we must respect them. It is wrong for us to be harsh and rude against them. Because our Imams did not practice this. Imam Ali alayhi salam did not practice this behavior. Even though he had a battle, and I'll discuss it briefly within my time, he had a battle with Aisha in the battle of Jamal in Basra. Even then Imam Ali respected her. But you find here, Ummul Mu'mineen, meaning you cannot marry them. When a woman marries the Holy Prophet, Shar'an, even if the Prophet divorces her, she can never remarry anybody forever. It's fixed for life. She becomes like a mother to us. Just like for us to marry a mother is haram, so is the wife of the Prophet haram for anyone to marry. That is why it's Azwaj Ummahatuhum. But can they enter hell? Well, let's ask the Quran. Quran, I mentioned this verse. Verse 60, Surah number 66, which is Tahreem. You find in Surah Tahreem, Allah says, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا امْرَأَةَ نُوحٍ وَامْرَأَةَ لُوطٍ. The example we give you are of the wives of Nuh and Lut. Nuh is a prophet of God. Lut is a prophet of God. كَانَ تَحْتَ عَبَدَيْنِ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. These are the two servants of Allah. But they are married to the two servants. So they are also Ummul Mu'mineen. Because they are also the wives of the prophets. And the rule is generic, it's universal. So you notice that they were disbelievers. Nuh's wife was a troublemaker. Lut's wife was a troublemaker. What does Allah say in the Quran? وَقِيلَ ادْخُلَ النَّارَ مَعَ الدَّاخِلِينَ. And on judgment day, they will be told, enter hell. But these are wives of the Prophet. Allah says, I have no distinction in this matter. That when you create trouble, even if you're the wife of the Prophet, you have no immunity from the fire of hell. See? But what is the quality of Khadija bint Khuwaylid, Ummul Mu'mineen, highest stature? She's gave all her wealth, and Allah is using her as a means to show us, look at the balance of Islam. Just like Allah uses Maryam to bring a key prophet, an Ulul Azam prophet, Isa alayhi salam, through Maryam without a husband, to show that there needs not be a man to touch her, but I will bring a prophet through her because she is sufficient to hold the banner of Islam, and she even becomes the connection of prophethood as a woman. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. In conclusion, even Asiya bint Muzahim, you know how good she was? She protected Musa. She is the one who took him from the river. She guided him. She guarded him. Guarded him. Protected him. And Fir'aun knew this. To the end, Fir'aun took a boulder and threw it on her and killed her. And when the boulder was hitting her, she says, رَبِّدْنِي لِعَنَّكَ لَيْتَ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. In same Surah Tahreem, Allah says, look at my example of the wife of Fir'aun. How great she was. And Maryam. How great she was. How great they were personalities. And what does Allah show as an example? That Islam is a balanced religion. It doesn't discriminate. It sees it within a balance, and let us see ourselves as Muslims as balanced. Tawassul bil-haq here is to look at the genders equal. Tawassul bil-haq is to look at the black and the white equal. In the same surah, Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah says, we made you male and female nations and tribes. Today, the sickness we have is in our discrimination against black people. The world has given a short end of the stick to our black communities. I know this video, this live broadcast is going to end, but I'm going to continue with my conversation briefly. So forgive me for continuing on this. Salat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
These two critical points, tonight being Saturday night, I want to take advantage of this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, and I'll discuss two verses, very critical verses, you'll see. Tawassul, what is bilhaq? Allah says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِهُ بَيْنَهُمَا فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَا عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبْغِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ فَأَتْ فَأَصْلِهُ بَيْنَهُمَا بِالْعَدْلِ وَأَقْسِطُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُقْسِطِينَ. This verse number 9, 49th chapter. Allah says, when two groups of Muslims fight, we have so many battles between ourselves. Shaitan, if there's one thing Shaitan works towards, is the groups fighting with each other. Here Allah says, وَإِن تَعِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَقْتَتَلُوا. No one brought to fruition this verse than Imam Ali alayhi salam in the battle of Jamal, when he fought Aisha. Aisha was the wife of the Prophet. She rose against the Khalifa of the time. You ask any Muslim in the world, you want to go out on the edge to try to validate this misdeed, no problem. God will raise you with that if you think it's valid. If you can dare to validate it, try it. Because you know, we're not foolish. We know when someone is duping us. We know when we're being cheated. Let's not cheat ourselves. Imam Ali alayhi salam went there and he said to Aisha, stop doing what you're doing. Because Aisha was very disappointed that Imam Ali became the Khalifa. She says, I will cause havoc and I will cause destruction as long as this man has become the Khalifa. So I asked the question, what did the Imam do? He taught us the akhlaq of debating and fighting. He said to Aisha, stop. He waited and waited and waited and kept having dialogue, but there was no room for dialogue. The way Imam Ali alayhi salam waited and waited to have dialogue with Muawiyah, there was no dialogue. The way Imam Hussein alayhi salam waited and waited and waited for dialogue with Yazid and Ibn Ziyad, there was no dialogue until it ended up in this clash. So Allah says, وَإِنْ تَعِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اَقْتَتَلُوا فَأَصْلِهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. When two groups of believers fight, make peace between them. Now if one group desists, Quran says, and if one insists on acting wrongfully, because that's a cancer, Allah says, fight them till you bring them back to justice. See? Look at the rule. It's very simple. فَإِنْ بَغَتْ إِحْدَاهُمْ عَلَى الْأُخْرَى فَقَاتِلُوا الَّتِي تَبَغِي حَتَّى تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ تَفِيَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ فَإِنْ فَاتْ فَأَصْلِهُ بَيْنَهُمَا. But if they quit, don't taunt them. Be nice to them. Be gentle with them. Bring them with justice. So when Imam Ali was on the battlefield, quick introduction. You need to know this, my brothers. I know some of you know it. May Allah bless you. But I must express it. You find in Islam, for a woman to go to battle is haram. Please know this. No time in history was a woman ever given the responsibility in Islam to go on a battlefield. You have Joan of Arc, but that's not Islam. In Islam, a woman cannot go on the battlefield and fight. It's very simple. But when they do go, it's a violation. This is our Islam, we need to know this. We need to understand the gravity, not to hash this out, but Allah is giving us an example. Then look at the extremity of this behavior. You have a woman who's disobeying. A woman who's now not only disobeying, she actually put herself in the camel, in a cage, in a camel, and she was directing the battle on the battlefield. You couldn't get it worse. Our Imam is looking at this dhulam, but notice he's not extreme, he's balanced. He knows this is a violation, but he's balanced. Tawassub bil haqq wa tawassub bil sabr. He says to one of his companions, go cut the legs of that camel. That camel is shaitan. Cut it. So one of the soldiers of Imam Ali alayhi salam goes and cuts the legs of the camel, and the camel falls. And when it falls, the battle stops. But unfortunately, within time, 20,000 Muslims were killed. 20,000 Muslims were butchered. You know how the battle started? Imam Ali alayhi salam is standing, dialoguing. He says, don't start. Aisha's army starts to throw arrows at Imam Ali's army. Because Imam says to her, stop, this is fitna. They start throwing arrows. They said there were so many arrows in the sky turned black. I want you to take one little lesson here in proactivity. This one moves my skin, I swear. I'm going to take a few moments, forgive me. Imam Ali alayhi salam looks at his son Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya. He says, Muhammad, take this banner, go to the front. This is Imam Ali alayhi salam we're talking. You know why I love him so much? You know why I admire him so much? I pray Allah raises me in his footsteps. I love him for this reason, besides many reasons. He looks at Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya and says, take this banner and go forward, my son. Muhammad looks at his father and says, Baba, the sky is black with arrows. It's dangerous. He hesitated for a moment. Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya was a good person. Muhammad ibn Hanafiyya says, I felt a breeze pass me. When I looked at my father and I hesitated and then I looked away for a moment, I felt a breeze pass me. And the next thing I saw my father with the banner on the front. See, he hesitated. Imam grabbed it and ran forward and stood on the front lines. He said, I saw my father standing there. What is the Imam telling me 14 centuries later? When your community hesitates to do Allah's work, when you have a project to do, and everybody is doubting, and everybody is wondering about the dangers post 9/11 of how Muslims are going to be attacked, Imam says, are you following my sunnah? Are you following my pathway, the pathway of Rasulullah? Which is, you don't doubt, you go, and you meet the enemy by the horns, and you bring it down, and you bring peace. This is what Imam Ali alayhi salam did.
when he defeated.
صل على محمد وآل محمد.
A few more minutes. You find that after he defeated Aisha, he sends Muhammad bin Abu Bakr. Those of you who don't know, Muhammad ibn Abu Bakr was the son of Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr's son, Muhammad, was like a son of Imam Ali. Imam Ali raised him like his own son. He loved him dearly. Muhammad bin Abu Bakr, who was the brother of Aisha. The Imam Ali alayhi salam sends him and says, go tell your sister to pack up and let us go back to Medina per the prescriptions of the Quran in Surah Al-Ahzab, where Allah says, وَقَرْنَا فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ. Remain in your homes. Allah is addressing the wives of the Prophet. He says, I want to fulfill it. Look, Imam doesn't go damn her, doesn't go beat her, doesn't go taunt her, doesn't curse her, doesn't give her bad names in public. None. He says, Muhammad bin Hanafiya, you go and tell your sister to get ready to pack up, and I will give her a safe journey back to Medina. She refuses. She refuses. Muhammad bin Hanafiya comes back and says to Imam Ali alayhi salam, says she doesn't want to listen to me. Imam sends Imam Hassan alayhi salam. Imam Hassan goes, history shows that she used to wear hijab in front of Imam Hassan. She would put on a hijab when Imam Hassan would enter the room because she didn't like Imam Hassan. No problem. Imam Hassan says to Aisha, pack up, my father has told you, pack up, leave. This was after defeat. Imam unanimously defeated her army. She refused. He said, Aisha, if you do not do what my father tells you, he will be forced to do something you will not like. She quickly packed up and left. So the companions asked her, what did he say that made you move so quickly? He said, that man, meaning Ali ibn Abi Talib, has the power to divorce me even today. Because Allah says, أَسَى رَبُّكُمْ إِن تَلَّقَكُنَّ أَن يُبْدِلَوْ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنَّ. See? Allah says who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, God perchance will divorce you. The messenger turns to Imam Ali alayhi salam and says, I authorize you to divorce any of my wives. And in history they stated, one of the reasons they didn't like Imam Ali alayhi salam was because of that honor the Prophet gave him, that even after his death, he said, I authorize you. This happened in history. What happened? Notice, Allah says, when they are subdued, do not taunt them. Bring justice, bring equity, take them back. Imam Ali with dignity takes her back to Medina and leaves her with dignity and never taunts her. This is the deen of Al-Islam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ala.
Tonight is the Shahada of Khadija alayhi salam. She died on the 10th, some say on the 11th day of Ramadan, after she returns from the Shaykh Abu Talib and the 13th year after, you know, on the last year, basically 10 years actually after the mission of the messenger. And you find that soon after the messenger had to do hijrah, and you find she died and she's buried in Jannatul Mu'alla. And tonight we commemorate this night for her, that even the shroud, some say that Allah brought the shroud for her, some say it was from a paradise, it was a fabric that was for her because Allah conferred upon her such honor. They say when Jibreel used to come with the message to the Holy Prophet, he used to give salam to Khadija. And he used to tell her that Allah sends salam to you, O Khadija. And she would say, salam is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the peace is with him and my return is to him. This is how Khadija alayhi salam was. Let us recite Surah Al-Mubarakah Al-Fatiha for all those who have deceased, who have left this dunya, and in their names, in the names of this great personality, the Khadija alayhi salam, Allah gives us the barakah to be like them. Al-Fatiha. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Rabbana aghfir lana wa li ikhwanina alladhina sabaquna bil iman wa la taj'al fi qulubina ghillan lil ladhina amanu rabbana innaka ra'ufur rahim. Allahumma inna narghabu ilayka fi dawlatin karima tu'izzu biha al-islam wa ahla wa tudhillu biha an-nifaq wa ahla. وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة. My brothers and sisters, let's recite the dua for the return of Imam Sahib al-Zaman عليه الصلاة والسلام. Tomorrow I will discuss a lot more about our blessed Imam and how Allah is establishing this world as it is today in the preparation of our living Imam, inshallah.
Let's recite together that Allah brings him soon so that justice prevails and equity prevails and harmony prevails. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Let's recite together. Allahumma kun li waliyika صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلة برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين صلى الله عليه وسلم محمد وعلى محمد